anywhere where you go, and it's harder than ever been before. And the people are drifting door to door, can't find no heaven, I don't care where they go. Be sure that these hard times will drive you from door to door. Mm-hmm.
got a letter this morning.
Nah, I just wanted to come out here to the cemetery or whatever, there or whatever, because I don't know, I'm always riding past the cemetery, I'm always getting a good feeling. And I don't know, I done rolled past a lot of cemeteries and I don't get that same feeling. Maybe I have some distant relatives out here somewhere, or maybe it's something beckoning and calling me, or maybe it's a story that needs to be told out here. And I always saw myself doing a lecture within a cemetery anyway. I always envisioned it, I always dreamed it, you know. With all my past experiences, you know, with dealing with the dead, you know, and all the spirits and whatnot. So I don't know what better place to do that, you know. And also another thing I want to add on was that Brother Sears was telling me that I have a Orisha, what is it, Yemaya? No, not Yemaya, Ogun, if I'm not mistaken. And that's the one that watches over the dead. I'm not real familiar with my Yoruba
Orisha
mythology, yeah, but I know about the Orishas. I know it's 16 of them, but I'm not sure exactly which one. But I think it's Oshun or whatever. And basically, he was just telling me that they watch over the dead, which is peculiar, in the fact that I'm wearing all white today. And this is, I don't know, like something told me to put on all white, you know. And it's, except for my shoes, but this is exactly what the Orishas wear, the Obatalas, or whatever, if I'm not mistaken, the Orisha priests. They wear all white when they're dealing with the dead, or they're dealing with conjuring spirits or reading or whatever, you know. I don't know. I didn't realize that actually until I got here. It's not like I planned that, you know. But yeah, so that's what I wanted to do. That's why I wanted to, you know, point out and bring out about this cemetery or whatever. And another thing, Brother Bobby was talking about this in one of his lectures, and I researched it, it is true that a lot of the cemeteries, especially with the white people, don't lag behind me. If you could get, I don't need the attitude, I don't need the hard breathing, and I don't need that. So if you could get like in front of me and stuff, okay. And that'll be helpful. And I don't know why you got it jacked all up there, but okay. you know.
Because I can see you.
But you could take the thing and twist it that way to you if you so short. Or whatever. If that's the case, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what works best for you.
That's why. Yeah, yeah. This worked best for me.
Okay, well, hey. You want to twist it right back up there?
I mean.
Like that?
That's the best for me.
You understand what I'm saying? Like if you short and you want to hold it up high, you can do so. And just if you short, you want to hold it up high, you can do so and just have it turned down that way or whatever way facing you. It won't hurt the angle you're getting it from. The way this is pointed won't matter.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever you choose to do, as long as it records, that's all I can really say.
It's recording now.
I'm aware of that.
Okay.
Yeah. And they got some nice trees out here on the property or whatnot. But I don't know. I always wanted to come out here and do some work and do some spiritual work. And like I said before, inside the other lecture in the Neo Morris Renaissance lecture, we was at Sesqui Centennial Park. I wanted to raise some of the dead, and maybe I can do some rituals. Not necessarily today, you know. Well, matter of fact, I am going to put one tutorial, a ritual tutorial, on tape today with the star language, and I'm going to put that down for record so people will know how to do it, because it's something that came to me, but it's a language that hasn't been spoken or enacted or realized in centuries, in an art form that hasn't been brought to life or hasn't been put down for the record in our current known occult society. So I do want to put that on record later on within a lecture or whatnot, but I don't know. Like every time walking through a cemetery, you know, I don't know, I just wouldn't mind coming out here. And I always saw myself coming out here with a different plates of food, you know? Different plates of food or whatnot. You know, if you could get like in front of me. That's why I wanted you to stay. I said it the first time. I said that. And like, you can stay like that. If you see me moving, then you automatically move. You're supposed to think of all that. You understand what I'm saying? You know, with a camera, you don't have to stare at it 24/7. So you can kind of like, you know. But okay. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to help you. You know. But yeah. But like, when I move like that, you're supposed to already be ready to move. And instead of like focusing on that, you ought to be focusing on what's coming, what's going, all that type of stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, soon as I take a little small little step, you ought to adjust for the step on the camera so it just be a smooth pan. That's like, you know, people don't need to know someone's holding the camera. You know what I'm saying? They don't need to know that. And I don't think that's relevant. You know what I'm saying? If they know someone's holding, what makes a good cameraman is that you don't realize you're watching life through a camera. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But that's just how it is or whatnot. And I don't know. I wanted to do a whole entire lecture based off of people being spirits being caught here inside the 12th dimension. Well, not the 12th dimension, but in 2012 inside of this dimension. Because I don't think this is 12th dimension at all. But I did want to shed light on some of the spirits that are constantly here, because as I'm walking through, I can feel a presence, like, you know, I'm supposed to be here, or this is supposed to happen, you know. And I have to come to a predominantly Christian cemetery, because nowhere else do we bury our dead. You know, for hundreds of years, we had to bury our dead within these type of cemeteries. So I must come to a Christian, because there is no Muslim or Islamic cemetery. You know, that's one of the questions I wanted to bring up. We talked about that, the Moors and these different righteous groups, but they don't have their own cemeteries and places to bury their dead. And that's one thing I did want to shed light on, you know, because if we're going to be conscious or we're going to put ourselves within a certain paradigm, we need to have a certain place where we bury our dead and place them and record them. We need to have that and have that on record, you know, and different styles of burials of death. Some type of way we need to enact that. Let's say we had some type of burial service where you get with the state, and the state, y'all create a contract or something. I don't know. Depending on what type of group you're in, whether you are Hebrew Israelite or Nubian or whatever. Wherever you want to be buried, with Malachi Z. York or the father, or whatever, or if you Clarence 13X or whatever. I mean, whatever. You ought to have it set up a certain type of way. and it ought to be a certain prepared burial, and it ought to be 100%, I wouldn't say, you know, consciously, you know, whatnot owned, you know, and I just wanted to put that on for record. So, you know, I think if we had our own cemetery, that'd be a great, great help for all of us, you know, not just some of us. But it's a lot of gnats around here, so. But yeah, I did want to get that on the record. Let's see. What else I want to touch bases upon? It's a lot of like forgotten love as well, you know?
Talk about the myths of cemeteries.
Well, you know, we have the misnomer that a lot of times cemeteries are based off of evilness, and a lot of people get that because I feel like somebody was pulling on my arm.
When I was standing right there when that car went past me, I felt something like this. That's why I looked down.
Yeah,
but I thought it was but you know what? Thought it was their energy that went past, though.
That could also be the case too, didn't being that they hurt or something.
Yeah, it was like this. I'm like, hold on. Well, it's probably, I was like, it's probably the energy that just as soon as they went past.
Could very well be. But I was gonna walk through there, but I changed my mind at the last moment.
Okay.
But back to this. In many cases or whatnot, we have a beckoning call. But I mean, what was that? Oh yeah, yeah. And we mix that with a lot of with scary movies, you know, movies that are talking about murder a lot. We mix a lot of that, you know, stuff you see like in Saw or whatnot. You mix a lot of that into what is now today known as your conception of what is death and what is demons and what are angels and so forth and so on. And that really stops a lot of people from indulging into a lot of our ancient sciences. But I know a lot of us already know that, but it's different when you know something and somebody tells you something, then you, I would say, re-know it, you know? Or get to reintroduce yourself into that information. And that's better, having an exterior knowledge. That's why I was telling Vicky, my sister last night, having an exterior knowledge. And it's good to have interior knowledge that you already know. That's the Akashic Records, you know what I'm saying? But having exterior, someone else letting you know from the exterior on the outside, and that way it clicks better. It does. That's one of the things we do need here. But yeah, I did want to talk about a lot of misnomers when it came to cemetery, especially dead people. They put a lot of they put a lot of scariness into it. And if you, a lot of people are fearful to even come out here at night. When I have dreams, it's me coming out here at night. I mean, literally with plates of food, going to different cemeteries and going to different grave sites and going to different people and different spirits because they want to eat different things. And a lot of times when I had that vision, it's me kind of like borderline going crazy, you know. But it's an actual real thing. I feel like that. I feel that if I tune in enough to what the dead has to say, I hear them. Most definitely. You okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I hear them most definitely. And that won't be an issue at all. Yeah, but that's how I feel or whatever. I mean, but never did we bury our dead the way that we do now. If you almost look at the way people do the dead now, like the cemeteries, they remove your eyes. They glue your mouth closed. They really mutilate the body. They stuff all kind of stuff inside you. You know, they say it's for certain purposes or whatever. Like if you're a woman, they put things within your you know, your lower area, and they say it's for you not to menstruate or urinate on yourself. And for to reduce the smell. I understand that. But I don't know. I don't know if I want anyone tampering with my relative after they've passed. You shouldn't tamper with the body in that way. You know? It's a lot of things that they do that I just don't 100% agree with. And then removing all of the life energy fluid out of the body, the blood. That even a Jehovah's Witness Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe in blood transfusions because they believe that's where the soul is at. That's why the Jehovah's Witnesses don't do blood transfusions, because they don't want nobody else's soul or their karma or their sins or anything they've done wrong inside their life mixing with their karma inside of their body. You know, and with that being said, I mean, we might want to step over here. But yeah, with that being said or whatever, yeah, that's why the Jehovah's Witnesses do that in the first place, you know? And I just wanted to let that be known. You know, I just want to let that be known. You know, and when I see a lot of people, make sure you get them in the background too. Mm-hmm. When I see a lot of people come
out. Can I zoom in?
Mm-hmm. When I see a lot of people come out, it's a lot of hurt on that young man. It's a lot of hurt on him. I'm not just saying it because we out here in the cemetery. It's just a lot of hurt, you know. It's a lot of hurt. Well, you can take it off him for a while, you know, because he might break down, you know. But yeah, one thing we associate, and you think you have to come out here to the actual grave site. Yeah, they're here, in some sense, but they're not necessarily here, because you know, when they say, Mama, you always with me, or Grandma, you always with me, or Grandpa, you know, or uncle, or cousin, or wife, or husband, you're always here. They are literally there, you know, but we disassociate ourselves with spirits altogether. So therefore, we have to go to a place, a designated place, where the spirit is alive. And everywhere else where that designated place is not, the spirit is not there. You understand what I'm saying? So therefore, The only people that kind of tap into anything spiritual or anything that has anything to do with the other world or the underworld, as some call it, you know, which it wouldn't be under anything, you know what I'm saying? Which is weird, but it's fine. I understand what they was trying to say. But with that being said or whatever, you would do it. Let's move out of the way for a little bit. The other thing was, it came through before with the other energy. And it kind of threw the whole tape off. Mm-hmm. I didn't want that. So it was done. It was their energy. It was their energy. I felt it again on my face. It was their energy that almost like a hate for me.
Yeah, like when I looked at
him. Almost like a disgust or disrespect. And he's blowing his horn at different grave sites. That's weird, because I saw the last time I saw Jay Ryder do that. A partner of mine, his brother is in the cemetery, and when he rolled past the border, he blow the boop, 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 and blow the horn at his brother. You know, and that's what the guy was just doing just then. I don't know if he was blowing at one of his relatives or whatever, but there's nobody there. At least that I can see. You know what I'm saying? So with that being said or whatever, we disassociate, back to what I was saying, you know, we disassociate a lot of the stuff inside of life with afterlife, with spirit, with mind, you know, and it shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be that way at all. I think that I think that the spirit is constantly with you, and it's only your mind that can perceive it at a certain time. That's an owl, or a raven. That's a raven, not an owl. But yeah, only your mind can perceive it at certain times. And so therefore, you say to yourself, Nana only at that particular site, you know, and they're only there doing that, you know. And our concept of what death actually is in the afterlife and heaven and hell is totally wrong. It's totally wrong. I wouldn't say it's totally wrong, but according to what I believe currently, it's not what I was taught. And that's why I was saying this on my other lecture before. We was at the Three Rivers conjunction. That everything we was taught when we was growing up. Matter of fact, I didn't even put that on tape. And so here's the time for me to put it on tape or whatever. Everything that we was taught when we was growing up is what was a lie. It sounds like it's something over there. They want me to come over there or something. I don't know. You know. But everything, that's what I got when I heard the sound. That's what I got, like, okay, over this way. So everything we was taught and when we was coming up is a lie. Everything. You know, saying nothing lasts forever. All these cliches. You know, what was it? The good die young, laugh now, cry later. I mean, they can be applied. Only God can judge me. You know, they can be applied. They can be applied, but it's so simplistic. it's so small. It's so, you know, it's such on a minute level. It's so apparent. It doesn't need to be said in that fashion as if it's wisdom. That's different. That's not to be confused with old folklore type wisdom, the brother said, a new broom will clean the house, but the old broom knows where the dirt is. And be careful. Make sure you get that on there. Yeah, a new broom will clean the house, and an old broom knows where the dirt is, and things of that nature.
So I can't even see it from the white or the manual.
Oh, it's cool. It'll pick up. The camera will pick it up.
Okay.
And so, I don't know, and all these different sayings, you know what I'm saying? Hand of one, hand of all, and all these different sayings that people have made. And with that being said or whatever, now those have knowledge, deep intrinsic knowledge, you know what I'm saying, with them. It may seem superstitious at times, but a lot of that has a lot of deep-rooted knowledge within it. Those old sayings that, you know what I'm saying, the grandma and the auntie used to say, that's not to be confused with these hood sayings and these neighborhood ignorant words of wisdom, supposedly. You know, that all of them almost always end in pain or anger or getting someone back or revenge, you know? So that's just how I feel about it. And so, I mean, we just need to come together and do more, you know? But, so it is what it is, you know? And, I don't know how often you ride through a cemetery and you see someone actually being recorded as if they're doing a lecture, so it may seem awkward, you know. I don't know. We got a lot of pain within him, but we already stated that. But yeah, that's basically how I feel about it. And I also want to put on a record or whatever, Osiris of the Underworld, to tap back into that. And how they were saying that Osiris is the Lord of the Underworld and the perfect black. Well, we had one of those Osiris mysteries in every single type of mythology. It wasn't just that Egyptian mythology. We had a different form of that in each different type of mythology. You know? What, you want to walk back that way? What do you want to do? That way?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, as you can tell, this cemetery is real big. You know? That's probably one of the reasons why I chose, because there's so many different stories. But however, I think that I heard Bobby or something said one day, he was saying that the soul, as long as the bones are living, the soul has some type of as long as the bones are in existence, the soul has some type of
like leverage or something?
Not necessarily leverage. The soul has some type of lockdown here. Mm. It's like kept here. And he was saying that soon as you die, you can come back and get reincarnated. And he was saying that I knew what he was saying. He didn't necessarily say this. I knew what he was getting at, because Bobby's a very
spiritual.
Very spiritual, because he gets up and says he's spiritual. I'm saying I done seen him in the spiritual realm. I've seen him in the astral realm. He's very spiritual. I see him in the meditative type of stance, you know, like Buddha almost. And it was thousands and hundreds of spirits coming all around him, whirling around him like a whirlwind, you know. And so, I mean, Bobby's very powerful. He's very powerful. And so that's I know that he's powerful. And these spirits he had at bay, no more some badass spirits. You know, I'm not talking about no regular, like, you know, old woman. You know, I'm talking about, you know, some Genghis Khan warriors. I'm talking about some people who used to fight with Shaka Zulu and stuff like that. You know, he had some badass spirits with him, and from New Orleans and stuff, and from slavery and stuff. So I mean, yeah, he's the truth. He's the truth. So is Phil Valentine. But back to the nature at hand. What he was saying was that the spirit, a lot of people think the spirit has something to do with the death and the afterlife, and they got a misnomer on the way that where it's centralized at. And well, I kind of lost myself
talking about the bones, and the, yeah.
Okay, cool. Now we back on point. Well, you were saying that's one of the reasons why the Egyptians, because I was trying to say, because my mind runs,
mm-hmm.
and I'm really talking to myself before I speak out loud, not just because I'm on camera, but you know what I'm saying, that's how I talk. So what he was saying was that's why the Egyptians didn't want to reincarnate. They didn't want to reincarnate because they didn't want to come back as some peasant, you know, especially the royal ones. So they wanted to preserve their bones as long as they could. He said that's why their bodies are still intact. And he was saying that's why they made it their objective to preserve life with the physical flesh as long as they could, because they know as soon as that dissipates, you may have to sign another soul contract. And so forth and so on. And they don't necessarily want to do that. Okay, I believe somewhat in that. I believe somewhat in that. I was telling you before, when that other guy died, there's a 3-day grace period I know about. I don't know if it's universal in every state for us every person, but I feel that it is. I feel that that it's like a 3-day grace period where you have to, you know, do what you need to do. And if you don't get that done, 3 days as far as like Earth days are concerned, or what appears to be 3 days. Okay, I just want to be precise. What?
No, because I was saying, I remember when I told you about my dream that I had about my cousins.
Mm-hmm.
Well, one of my cousins,
mm-hmm.
the one that's not dead.
Mm-hmm.
And I said that in my dream, you know, remember I said that he died in my dream,
mm-hmm.
but you know, his spirit was still alive or whatever, and we had smoked a joint with his spirit because he had a couple of more hours left on this earth, like, you know, spiritually or whatever.
Yeah, I remember you told me that, and I'd already had a dream about that. Like, I was asking someone, I was asking a spirit when I was taking them to another place, right? Well, the real place was a sub pocket of their own mind, but what appeared to be heaven, because that's where they wanted to go. So with that being said, I asked him, I said, how long you been around? He said, man, I've been doing this for a while, you know, where it seemed like forever to him, but it was only a couple weeks, you know. Another like essence came and said, you have like a corridor of like 3 days. You have like a corridor of like 3 to 4 days.
Yeah, and that's so, when you told me that.
Yeah, so yeah. I was like, well, I think it's a corridor of like 3 to 4 days, especially when that presence is heavy here.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, like a lot of times people don't want to leave. You know, they don't want to leave. They don't want to go anywhere.
I also think like when you do, you know, when you when people die and people set up, I wanted to say cemetery, but when they set up funerals.
Mm-hmm.
Especially like, you know, it's almost like their names are like kind of chanted spiritually in all the living, like that goes to the funerals. You know what I'm saying? You know how you chant something, like, you know how like when the Indians chant it in the rain?
Mm-hmm.
Like being there, like, you know, all these, like when you first die, you still fresh on everybody's mind, and it's like at the same time. So it's like all those thoughts about you collectively holds a lot of weight.
Yeah, I believe that. Yeah, you're right about that. But also that comes to helps you come to grips that you are dead. But what if you missed that whole ceremony? Like that movie Sixth Sense. He didn't even go to his funeral. He didn't even know he was dead. He had been dead for months and still navigating around, wondering why his wife ain't talking to him. Think she was upset at him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, it depends on how in tune you were as a human being. Just like C. Freeman L. said, if you were a dumbass human being, I mean, of course that was what you were supposed to do, but if you didn't apply none of the science and get to know none of the science or any science, ain't none of my science, you could have gotten known any science for that matter. Educate yourself and become I believe each soul has worth. I believe that the more worth you has, the more, you know, work you're obligated to do. So, you know, so with that being said, the greater and worth that you grow, you know, you get to go to different levels that wouldn't exist at all for other individuals that didn't do any work. That's how I believe, you know what I'm saying? that's not to say that, you know, worth is measured by knowledge, but that is to say that knowledge could be a form of worth. Worth could also be measured by experience. You know, it depends on the individual and the circumstance and where their desired place is to go and how their particular situation is and how their connection is with their upper self or higher self or God. So now that I've covered all that, I want to dip back into that Christian thing, because when the preacher's over you, our Father which art in heaven, and you know, hallowed be thy name, and he's doing all that, and then they have something they do in Catholicism, they have something they do inside of Islam, they have something they do, each one, whether it's the imam, whether it's the preacher, whether it's the bishop, they lean over the body and they say something. Now, I was told by one of my brothers or whatever, he was saying that at that particular moment, that little prayer that they say, they take the actual soul. That's why preachers have a little juice, because they got remnants and fragments of different souls within them. They holding like I would say like the Ghost Rider. You know, they're holding like a link in their chain or a bead or something like that. Not purposefully, just haphazardly, because they're thinking that that person has their key to salvation. Like, so they're waiting on them to take them somewhere. But that person ain't got no, that person has enough juice to obtain it, or enough illusionary juice for you to follow them, but not to take your soul nowhere. That's why when I was I just got a rise in energy. That's why when I was gliding, I went to the pyramids. You know, when I was gliding, I was seeing all these people. You know what I'm saying? It was amazing to me when I heard, I think it was Brother Panic that said, had the exact same dream. That's why I said, okay, it's real. You know what I'm saying? Like, had, for someone to have the exact same dream and it's on the same level, okay, that, you know what I'm saying? Like, come on. You know what I'm saying? I knew it was real when I had it, but it just further confirmed. Like, you know what I'm saying? Two people that had the exact same dream and don't even conversate with each other. And you know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't really share the dream. I shared fragments of the dream, because I knew if you haven't never been there, you wouldn't never know it. So I was floating or whatever, and I would see hundreds of people, like in grave sites like this, like it would be hundreds of people just sitting around, you know, like inside of what's the name of that place? And like inside of the mosque, like when you go inside the mosque, everybody holds hands and they face a certain direction. Well, it's kind of like that, except people be on the inside. It's so many people. It's people from the 1800s, people from the 1400s, people from the 1300s. You know what I'm saying? People that just recently died. You know, that's thousands of people that attended that church, or attended that mosque, or attended that masjid, or you know what I'm saying? Or attended that synagogue. You know, so they'll be in a line. They a lot of times their head will be pointing at the central pillar of that church, or the central obelisk, or the central cross of that church, and they'd be sitting there waiting. And whatever comes by, like let's say it's an angel, let's say it's a demon or whatever, you know what I'm saying? Because I really want to get into what are angels and what are demons, and what can be perceived as an angel, what can be perceived as a demon, because there is no difference. You know what I'm saying? Angels are demons. You know what I'm saying? It's just based off how you look at them. You know what I'm saying? But anyhow, the head will be pointing at that direction. They'll all just be huddled around like penguins. Just like penguins. You know how they get cold and they'll huddle around each other, and they be in a circle. They crowd around the church or grave site, or it's hundreds of them out here. You understand what I'm saying? And not to say that I can't see them, but at this particular time, see, my spiritual lens has been, see, my more rational side has been taken over. See, when rationality starts taking over, you get to analyze spiritual shit. See, I know I'm jumping, but I'm gonna get back to that. Like, I noticed right quick, I wanted to hit that or whatever. I noticed that with myself or whatever, I noticed that spirituality, it tends to jump on. It tends to attack and grab hold of me and seize me in some type of way. And I just enjoy the ride. And then after a couple years or whatever, or after a couple months or maybe a couple weeks, I go back into this rational mode, beginning to even question the experience of whatever I just experienced, or whatever I just saw, whatever vision I just had, or whatever I just received as a download within a meditation or something. So, you know, that's me actually analyzing it, and it gets filtered through the logical side. And at that time, my spiritual side almost shuts the hell down. And then I go through another experience where my rational mind must shut down in order for the spiritual to even be recognized. Because if you're running around here and you're a mathematician and you're this scientist and this world-renowned engineer or this world-renowned architect or this, you know, if you're just a completely logical individual, if your whole life is based off logic, which is great, you understand what I'm saying? You will be a spiritual baby. I mean, case in point, look at most of the people who run the world now. They're not spiritually inclined at all. I mean, that's just how it is. You can't be both. One has to shut down in order for the other one to work. Just like you can't talk and listen at the same time. You can't be both. There's no way you can do that. No way. But that's just based off my experience. You know, but what was I getting at before that?
You were talking about the dreams and...
Yeah, okay. So, you know, I saw that. I just saw thousands of people that was just lost. You know, thousands of people that was just lost. And I saw it at all the churches and the synagogues. I saw it at all the places that were like pyramids. I saw it at Kentucky Fried Chicken places. You know, I saw a whole bunch of that. You know, I saw a whole bunch of that. And I really said to myself, man, they just lost. And that's why I was hitting the thing with the preacher, whatever. I was saying what I was saying about the preacher, whatever, because he don't actually mean that. So a lot of times these people think they have a remnant of what he was talking about. This person's gonna lead you somewhere, and then they end up holding or leasing your soul. And so it's not your entire soul. They can never have your entire soul, because, like, you know what I'm saying, you're just a fragment or a particle of what God is. You know what I'm saying? So it can never be your entire soul. But it's like particles and essences and fragments of, you know, your soul, because soul is based off memory. And that's what I'm actually realizing. Soul is based off memory. Like, if someone lives within your mind, that person could not even exist, but nevertheless be an entity somewhere. And therefore, they can have some type of soul or physical or spiritual experience through that, and you could give them life. And therefore, the same for someone who actually did exist, who you just remember now, who's no longer physically here, but you have a memory of a certain time period that, you know what I'm saying, is stored within your memory banks or whatever, you know, within your cerebellum or whatever. So you have that to hold in a tangible place or whatever. So therefore, it's fragments of that person that actually lives on through you exercising the thought of memory. So they live within your mind, literally. If that makes any sense. And that's okay, case in point. You give them juice by even thinking about them. Case in point, when you saw the Clash of the Titans, he said they're no longer thinking about us. And Zeus started disappearing. He started fading away. And the other guy, Hades, which is, you know what I'm saying, every time they show you the underdog, they're really talking about a polarity type of thing. They're not talking about something that really took place. So Hades was coming up through there, whatever, and Hades was getting stronger because people started to fear. Fear drove him up from the underworld. And so the more fear was prevalent, the more he became stronger and more visible and more real.
Just like Freddy Krueger.
Just like Freddy. Just like Beetlejuice. Just like they say voodoo. Just like they say superstition. It only can hurt you if you believe in it. So they say that's like skeleton key.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, you actually create these entities, okay? But know that there are subsidiary exterior forces outside of yourself. But holistically speaking, no, there's not. There's only one. There's you and the all. Well, not and. There's just you and that's it. You understand what I'm saying? But know that in an individualistically or unholistically way of speaking of it or matter of looking at it, everything's divided, you know, and therefore you share your experience with yourself and, you know, your own soul, and that's how you come to grips with that. I mean, that's the best way I can put that. You know what I'm saying? We have our own experience, but it's meant to be perceived from our per
our standard of perception or where we're standing at to, you know, pull it in. That's our individual present to the world or present to existence. You know what I'm saying? Or present to matter itself. You know, so that's why your purpose for even being alive is. So once you get that down, then you say, okay, if the purpose for life is to do that and engage and just be, you know, for the sake of being and do what thou wilt. And that is the law. You know, that's aristocratic. But that's truth. Even though I don't agree with a lot of the practices he does, especially, you know, the homosexuality, but he has some science to him. Now, unless a science to be had or a science to be realized in each facet of life, you know. So, you know, with that being said or whatever, I just wanted to say, I think that we should study more. I think we should study more. I think we should study our dead too, you know, because we don't. We really, really, really don't. We really, really, really don't. I think that we shouldn't fear death. We should welcome it. But like I said before, it's a misunderstanding. And I'm gonna show you how to walk inside the graveyard, because you about to walk on. When I mean it's not hurting them, but you know, just respect. Out of respect, like you would walk along this line here, and you can record that for the camera too, so people on the camera will. Like you would walk along this line here, you see it? You can come behind me, and this line here, and come right here, you know what I mean? Yeah. So therefore, you wouldn't be walking on this, and like let come right here and point it this way, and you would walk along this line here, behind. You understand what I'm saying?
How you know which way they? Okay, because in front of.
Because the way that's where they bury the body.
Okay.
Yeah. And it look like it's not even enough room for another human being right.
That's
there.
Why I say.
But you know, it's not disrespectful, but it's just the way I was taught. Because all my people is like undertakers and all that type of stuff, you know. So that's the way I was taught. So I just out of respect, you know what I'm saying? I don't know how it is disrespectful, but I think it's disrespectful if he was a living physical being to step on someone. So, I mean, I don't know. I just want to respect them in any way possible. If that's the way they do it and they get along with the dead pretty well, I'm all abide by that until otherwise. But what you was about to say?
No, I was just talking about cemeteries, period, and the business and, like, just what I think about it.
Go ahead.
When you go to a cemetery, especially such as this one, well, I would say this about cemeteries. You got like two different types of cemeteries. You got cemeteries that have bodies that been here since, like, you know, from a certain time period, like, you know, from current. And then you have cemeteries that's been here, you know, before that, like in the 1800s, people that were born like in the 1800s, early 1900s. Mm-hmm. You know, when I was saying the current, you got people that was born, you know, that's buried here. You know, that been around since, like, you know, the 30s, 40s, and just died maybe, you know, in the 90s, you know, 80s, 60s, 2000, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So when I look at the cemetery, and, like, especially when it be the same size since I've been younger, you know what I'm saying? Like, okay, I'm speaking of when, okay, I'm from Cincinnati, so, like, the cemetery that I've been brought around, I've been brought around all my life, especially throughout all the family members and people that I know that died or whatever. So, like, my question would be, like, okay, how do they have enough room for all these people? You know what I'm saying? Especially when my little sister died, we had a funeral for my little sister. And when you see, like, how close the plaques are, and, I don't know, I just use my rational mind and think about, like, the dimensions when the size you need to bury somebody. And I be feeling like, well, it seems like that they just, you know, they bury people on top of each other, or, you know, that they don't really, I don't know, that's just my thoughts on it.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that they bury people on top of each other, but that's not to say that they haven't done that. To add on to what you're saying, I felt like it was something coming from that way anyway. But to add on what you were saying, that it was a case like that here, Levy's funeral home. Here in Columbia, they had mass bodies, and they was you know, just for one of these little plots. Like, for example, with this plot right here, you know, all due respect, they're charged for this gravestone here, right? And so that's a couple,
You see?
Mm-hmm. Married.
Yeah, married couple. Married June the 6th. Okay? It says Ray and Happy. That may be two different people. Happy, it may be one person. Ray may be another person.
You know? Mm-hmm. That's maybe that nickname or something.
Yeah, maybe. And you see the two marriage rings right there. It's two people sitting right there, right? They would put that up, that right there, that whole get up right there, it's probably about $8,000.
What, the stone or just the...
The stone itself is probably about $1,500. The casket itself is probably like $5,000. The burial and the services and all that type of stuff can range. You know what I'm saying? But a lot of caskets, not the minimum you're going to pay is $5,000. Just like they killing it. They killing it.
Yeah.
They really pimping it like the food industry. They doing everything wholesale and industrializing grave and cemeteries now.
That's because, that's like I said, that made me go, like...
The average price for a funeral, I'm just hating to cut you off right quick. Like from seven to it can range. Seven to start at seven and go on up. 20, 30. I know the people spend $25,000 on a funeral. Go ahead, what you're saying.
Nah, but that makes me go back to what I was saying as far as like, you know, I noticed that when they, you know, since I've been younger and then like me growing up and seeing that the cemeteries are still the same size, because you do have some cemeteries where you can see they doing construction and getting more land.
Expanding. Yeah.
Expanding, exactly. But when you don't see them expanding or a cemetery that doesn't expand and you look out throughout the years, like, okay, I mean, how many people would you say on average die in a city such as Columbia or such as Cincinnati? Well,
I don't know. I wouldn't even begin to speak on those type of statistics because I would have to know first.
Yeah, and then you got to think about how many people would you say a year comes through this cemetery?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, like, when you think about that and you don't see, you know, like I said, the cemetery expanding, where are they putting these bodies?
That's true.
That's what I think about, like, you
That's
know.
True. That's true.
And then you see the plaques, like I said, all clustered up and... You know, you see the old ones and then you see them mixed in with the new ones, or you know what I'm saying? So that was just my thoughts on it.
Yeah, I think you got a good point there, and that's a good question. I mean, they're not finna say, oh, we don't have any more space. They're gonna save the space. Because like when my grandma died, she wanted to be buried with my grandfather. The twin site thing, you can go ahead and buy your plot. That's $2,700 if you buy it in advance. That's just for that's not including the casket, not including the headstone. That's just the lot. You know, they call it grave plots. You can buy them in the newspaper. So I just find that to be interesting, and how you pay so much for those type of things. You know, I don't know. It's big business. People dying now is big.
I mean, because everybody got to die. So, I mean, yeah, it is. I would say so.
Yeah. It's big, big, big business. I mean, but one of the things I also wanted to touch on or whatever is how we need to, did we walk into a bed of gnats or something?
Oh, no. We probably did.
Or and also gnats sometimes will be a spirit.
Yeah, I was just gonna say we just got off of that one that grave site that mm-hmm. grave right there. So, mm-hmm. you know, it could have been aggravated. That's, you never know.
Yeah, it could have been aggravated by what I was saying, or it could just want me away,
mm-hmm.
or it could want me, period, or mm-hmm. want me to.
You want you to turn back around.
Turn
or
back
something.
Around. You know, and that's could be spirits as well. Not could be, but all.
It could be carrying like the form, the balls that they form.
Them together collectively.
Mm-hmm.
You know, them together collectively make up one soul,
mm-hmm.
or a fragment of amount of space it would normally take inside of one body.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So yeah.
Now they show you in movies all the time, especially cartoons, like Finding Nemo, when they had like the swarm of fish all together. And they was like moving collectively, like making shapes and, you know, making like a bigger fish, like with the...
Exactly.
You know, exactly. They do that. I noticed they do that in cartoons a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And they associate like butterflies with women. They associate like bees with babies.
Mm.
Bees and insects with children.
Mm.
You know, they do. Just like when they show somebody like Snow White, they'll show her in a light and they'll show her with a whole bunch of little small birds around her.
Mm-hmm.
And insects, you know, not insects like flies and gnats buzzing around or bothering or whatever, but they're sure like birds chirping and
You know, those type of things mean she's connected to the spiritual world. That's not something that immediately registers within the mind, but that's something that comes along with it. And to touch on another subject, Bobby was saying, like, the Baron Zombie image is, and I've always been attracted to the image. Always. I always was attracted to that image, that top hat image.
Yeah.
With, that top hat image with
the skeleton.
Yeah.
And
hold on
for
a second.
Damn. Yeah, they all around you now.
Where?
Look, I mean, you can see. So they all around and they keep coming over here to me too. But it's cool. Okay, yeah. And wave, ooh. Wave your hand.
No, I'm not gonna wave my damn hand.
Okay. Okay, that's enough.
I don't know. Some white people probably say,
it's still with you.
Hold on, they are?
Yeah. I know, so when I do that, sometimes you gotta run a good
bit. Yeah, you're right about that.
Because they'll follow you.
Well, stop recording.
Come on, Dale.
Come on, baby.
Hands on.
Yeah, because those gnats were getting ridiculous. But yeah, I want to, what?
I want to say something like, when you just said those gnats got ridiculous, because it's like, it was a little bit, then it was more, then it was,
yeah,
more.
It was more.
I think that's also associated with like death and spirits, because a lot of times, like when people show spirits and stuff, like especially on TV, they tend to show them bum rushing you. You know what I'm saying? Just like how the nets were.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? They'll come real fast, and then you just get like, oh, I can't stand it. And
but
just
that's not necessarily true all the time.
Really?
Like spirits don't come and attack you.
I mean, but you, like, I'm saying that's what's
time,
in your mind.
Every time I had, I know what you're saying, but that's not true though.
Okay.
Well, at least for me, in my spiritual experiences, because every time that I dealt with a spirit, I mean, a couple of times they get right in your face, and those are the kind that scare you. But most of the time they're real subtle, like real smooth and real subtle and real gracious, you know, and a lot of times they don't want to scare you. Like my grandmother, whatever, she, when she came to me, she made me forget that she was even dead. I forgot that she was dead. She wiped that part of my mind away. And we and her was shopping and stuff, because that's the most fun I ever had with her. We used to, when my dad used to get his food stamps, and we used to go inside of the store, and me and her used to have fun just buying food. Just buying food, just little snacks. She loves snacks. She's a big junk person. She loves
Fig Newtons.
No, she doesn't. Hold on, I got.
Okay, I'm sorry. I thought you said.
No, I didn't say she loved Fig Newtons at all. I got that from my mom.
Okay.
She loves those golden fish, Cheez-Its, Ritz crackers, those cheese doodles. ginger snaps. Oh man, you name the chip, she'll eat it. You name the chip. But that's basically, she's a big junk person. And then when she came to me, I realized, when I was coming to, when I was waking up, I said, Grandma, you dead. Hakim. I said, Grandma, you dead. She said, she said, yeah, I am. I just didn't want to scare you. And that's not what she brought me up. She brought me up, and I went back inside the dream, because you can do that. I went back inside the dream. I said, no, I got something to say to that woman, because she had just died. I had a few things. She said, I'm proud of you while you in school. I think you're doing well, son. She said, but I'm okay. I'm doing what I need to do. I'm going on inside the light. And I was like, all right, cool. And then she went ahead and put me back inside my body, like, all right, I'll talk to you later. And that's the last time we talked. I knew she was good, you know, but but me and her had a lot of fun in grocery stores. And so sometimes people will come to you inside of, you know, settings that y'all are for real familiar with, or inside of settings that y'all had a lot of fun with. You know,
to less alarm you,
yeah, because they don't want to scare you. And believe me, the ones that scare you all the time don't want to scare you. That ain't their objective. I want to scare you. Some of them are. Some of them are assholes. Just like when they was humans, they was assholes. You know what I'm saying? When they, you know, all they did was suck on 40s and beat on women. So some of them still beating on their wife inside the afterlife. And if that wife and that spirit is in agreement, and they stay together for life, then they gonna beat on each other. And that's what they, he gonna let her, she gonna let him beat on her for eternity. And they somewhere in the astros fighting and getting drunk, still smoking crack and beating on each other. arguing over who got the last stem and who got 20 on a 30 rock. Is there, does heaven have a ghetto? Hell yeah, it got a ghetto. Hell yeah. It, heaven has whatever you conjure up to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because heaven is a figment of the mind. So is hell. But, you know, I'm about to introduce that that practice I was talking about. Now I'm going to wrap it up from there. All right, so you can do it. You know? And we can just hop inside the car and drive to another location because the gnats is ridiculous.
I was saying, hold
that
hand way, cemeteries. I was told to be afraid, like, you know what I'm saying? I'm saying it because, like, now that I'm thinking back on what actually happened and what emotions came from the fear, like, was when my mom and, you know, like, the grown-ups would tell you, like, you know, don't point at that, you know, don't point at the cemetery, yeah, whatever, bite your finger.
It's actually their fear. It ain't your fear.
Yeah,
fear.
Bite your finger. Don't look at it before, like, it was bite your finger. I was told not to look at this. I was told not to look at the cemetery or they'll come and get me. You understand what I'm saying? So, like, I really got my fear from them. And being that, you know, I was really curious about the cemetery, especially the more and more they tell you, like, don't do this, don't do that. I mean, but I think that's just naturally as a child, you know. But I became more curious about cemeteries and then about death, like, you know, and that made me question about, like, you know, where you go, you know, that drew up all those questions that, you know, what kids, you know, ask. So, I mean, I never really was afraid of cemeteries. I really wasn't. And I will also say, I mean, I feel that, especially the dead, I don't understand how people, parents, you know, teach their kids to be afraid of cemeteries because of dead people. You know what I'm saying? And because of spirits, but they don't teach them about spirits.
Yeah.
I don't understand it. It's like spirits don't exist. But when it comes to cemeteries, they want you to be afraid because they think they telling you that the spirit's gonna come and get you. Like, that's like, that don't make sense. Yeah, I think parents should stop teaching their kids to be afraid of spirits.
Yeah.
And cemeteries, it's all together. Dead people, spirits, or whatever you want to call it. You know, the whole shebang that comes with dead people. You know what I'm saying? Like, because you know, the child becomes very confused.
Yeah. You're right about that.
Well, here we go.
Mm-hmm. You weren't recording the whole time?
Yeah, I was recording.
Okay, cool.
Well, I'm still recording, so.
This is the last little part. I'm going to wrap it up.
I'm just happy we're away from those nets.
Yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah.
It felt a lot cooler on this side,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it do. It's a whole different energy.
Wow.
But I just go with what the spirit go. The spirit told me to stop here, so I stopped. What? What's wrong?
I was saying, let me see if it's on manual.
It's not if the fly was up there.
Okay.
You got it on there?
You push this. And it's not going. Here we go, babe.
It's fine?
It's fine.
Okay. Yeah, you know, like you were saying, like, they don't really tell us nothing about spirits, you know, but, I mean, but they expect us to fear them. I know I saw something just then. Can't tell me that. Yeah. It's like a guy that had on black or something, or some type of entity that was hiding between the tombstones just then. I know I saw it. You know what I'm saying? But however, Yeah, but they don't tell us how to deal with spiritual matters. That's because they don't know anything about spiritual matters.
Yeah.
They don't know anything about spiritual matters. I mean when I was nice to ask about spirits and where do they come from or where do they go or whatever, to pastors. Like my granddad was a pastor. And me and him never really sat down and had a talk like this, but you know, I know a lot of pastors that did. And none of them are spiritual at all. Because you already know that religion hinders you from being spiritual, point blank, period. And some people say, oh, I'm spiritual, but they don't know what the word spirit means. And that's one of the things I want to talk about, because I don't see a difference between the soul and the spirit, like two separate entities.
Yeah.
I don't see that. I don't see that at all. Like people, oh, that's the bar, oh, that's the car. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Like, that doesn't make, that's you, when you're dealing with a dualistic reality, yeah, that makes a whole lot of sense. To restore balance, you must have, okay, when you're dealing with it from that point of view, I'm at a certain level where there is no dualism. There's just oneness. So, you know what I'm saying? Not to disrespect anything, you know, but that's the level I'm at with it. So, you know, with that being said or whatever, I'm going to say this. I think there's just, you know, what was I saying?
Oh, you're talking about with spirits and, you know what I'm saying, how, you know, people don't really know the difference between spirit and soul. And
yeah, soul. Yeah. So that lady just said, don't talk to her like that. All right. But yeah, so, that's feather there.
Man, we used to collect them. Never mind, but that's besides the point.
Yeah,
you're right.
And we did, though. So, I don't know. I used to, I don't see no difference between soul and spirit. I really don't. I see spirit. Yeah, see, you letting me come too close, you know? I see spirit, and I see soul, but I see spirit as a reflection. I see spirit as the force that drives the soul, and I see soul as the actual individual thing that people are referring to. I see spirit as just another expression, but not a total different thing, or not a separate entity. What you about to say?
You know, like a pulse?
Yeah.
Or like a, because you know how like a pulse, it acts like an electrical current. You know how it's like a boom, boom, boom. Mm-hmm. How you describing it, that makes me look at the spirit in that way, as the pulse of the soul.
Yeah.
That's
driving factor.
Yeah.
It's not a separate entity. You know what I'm saying? It's a driving factor. You know, it's not a separate entity. But yes, I wanted to go ahead and do that exercise if I could. See how this tree just fell down. I remember when we was little, we used to take this little type of stuff, and I used to go in there like that and break that down. I don't know.
Oh yeah, I used to always break up the tree stump. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
So what you do is you close your eyes and then you picture a certain area above you or a star above you. You can get a shot of the and you picture a certain star above you, because it's always a star no matter where you're at. We in space. It's always a star above us somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
You take that frequency and tune in with your mind and tune in to whatever star is above you, and it'll just start pouring information down to the top of your head where your crown chakra is located at, and just let it come down into there and just let it flow. And so you tune into that, and then actually then you speak whatever language or whatever sound frequencies come to your mind. And that's what I call the star language. So an example would be and this is where you get speaking in tongues from. Because people just tapping in, but just in a Christian way. It's an ancient exercise. And I just did it haphazardly one day, and then found out what I was doing later on after a few trial and errors. So, Hafuna kachi a fa ola kafun a nina. Hiwa wala chan wa kafoli. Ah, sina, fucking wa chal, wali, bulu, uli kimana sina wa ma bulu, nala. Like, kind of like that. And another thing I wanted to add on is that, like when you saw me like is a word, like that's one thing. I, after doing that a couple of times, I realized that like is a word. These different grunts and these are different words. So that's why some people get pissed off when you suck your teeth or you, that's a word, you know? Not necessarily a bad word, but a word nonetheless, you know? And the energy is kind of low here, but nonetheless, I'm gonna try to attempt to raise just people up in this soul cemetery, you know? Not raise them up, but to take them to, I would say, okay, well, I can't raise them up if I don't know what I want to do with them. Well, that's a meditational thing I'm gonna do from home. You know, because that's gonna take a while. But, you know, and not just trying to be Billy Badass for the tape and just do something on tape. You know what I'm saying? But that's the exercise. I'm gonna go back into the exercise. A lot of people just wanna like do something and they get spiritual and next thing you know, it's all weird and they talking forever and they trying to be Billy Badass. I'm the most connected spiritually. I'm not trying to do all that. That's not my aim. But yeah, so that's how you do that, you know.
You do feel like it is something that's calling you to do something for these, you know, spirits here at the cemetery. Oh yeah, nonetheless.
Oh yeah. As soon as I did that, I felt that. Mm. You know, so that's how you would do that. Like I said, you know, you would just say whatever come to your mind, like Hachiwan ba fa, ha miko kwana, ha wila ba, buma, umma achina kala, hali wa wachima wa fuma ba ba chiwa, ula, hifa, chali go wa na kuwa na na shino fu, hali. You know, like That's how you would do it. So that's just an example. And like I said, if you could try your own exercise, it don't matter how dumb you sound. You know, don't worry about trying to make sense.
Cause you're not.
Cause you, yeah, it may make sense. You know, one time I was talking in straight Chinese, Mandarin, up and down. You know what I'm saying? I don't know a lick of Chinese. You know, and I ain't a big Chinese watcher either. So I don't know where that came from. Can't say it came from the subconscious of my mind because I don't know enough sounds in Chinese to make a cohesive anything
language,
anything, yeah. Even mumbo jumbo in Chinese, you know. So with that being said, you know, I was saying you know, peace or whatever, and peace be on you. Until next time, when I every time I do a lecture, I want to kind of do like a show you other stuff I do. Like the next one I do, I'm probably going to show you how I do the water ritual. And I have a water ritual I do, and I'm gonna do it like that. You know, but the water ritual, well, basically the water ritual is basically the same thing, except for when you want to blockade yourself off from a spirit, you would say the star language into the water, program the water. Never drink water without programming. Never. It don't matter if you say Islam. Just say Islam over the water or Hotep. Always do that. Just a quick look, Islam. You know, and that's it. You don't gotta pray over the shit, you know, or none of that. You ain't gotta sit on long shit. You could, you know what I'm saying? And if you have some intent into that, and that intent will go into the water and that program the water. You have to sit there and say an hour long ritual. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot of that stuff is very time consuming. You gotta remember the whole ritual, and it's not for that. You're not supposed to sit there and try to recite something that somebody else deemed important. I know I saw something white move that way. You saw it?
Mm-mm.
Okay, go ahead.
Now, I also want to say, like, I think when it comes to spirituality, especially, like, when it comes to the ritual that you referring to, like, you know, programming your water, it shouldn't be the same every time you drink your water.
Well, now, I can't say it shouldn't be the same either, because I use the same one. I can't necessarily say it shouldn't be the same. What I'm saying is you should do what you want to do.
Yeah.
If that's what you feel that... I'm just trying to, the purpose of the exercise, let me go to
okay,
the purpose,
it's a
okay, so you can get a understanding of why I want you to do that. Purpose of exercise is for you to start utilizing your mind to control materialistic things around you. That's the overall purpose. But you must start out with something as simple as a glass of water. And then there, you start trying to, you know what I'm saying, say, okay, I have control over the glass of water. Not only do I drink it, I program it to, you know, the molecules to move how I want them to move in a certain type of fashion to, you know, vibrate at a certain frequency. And therefore, you start increasing your own personal vibration based off of things that you program and things you created. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it depends on what type of intent you have. That always matters. It depends on the angle and, you know what I'm saying, how intense you are with whatever you believe in. And it depends on what you believe in. You know what I'm saying? All that matters. Those are factors. Nonetheless, I just want you to start doing something. Instead of just sitting around watching lectures, thinking you deep, you know, and that's cool and all to think you deep or whatever, because it's a hiatus. And I was on a hiatus for a while. You know what I'm saying? I became a lecture junkie, as some people say, or whatever. But I mean, ain't nothing wrong with that. You know what I'm saying? But I don't want you to become dependent on other people's thoughts and not develop thoughts of your own. The objective at the end of the day is for you to become a creative individual. I had to break myself from that. I want you to break yourself from that. I want the sound of my voice and things that I say not to follow me. I want the sound of my voice and my thoughts I'm trying to program in a certain way so it can unlock and unhinge certain creative elements within your own mind so you can bring forth your experience and where your angle that you're standing from with it and how you can bring forth more information that I never tap into because I'll never be you. So I want that to be that. And I could never do that. I can do that for me. I'm just enjoying my experience and I'm expressing and rationalizing my experience. We don't jot down enough of our experiences. You need to study your emotions. You know what I'm saying? That's what I do. I study my emotions. Like, that's not to say when I'm crying, I may stop crying and write a paragraph. No, but that's to say that I do study the result of my face and how it feels after I may cry and how my eyes feel. Like, oh, my eyes don't normally feel that way. Oh, my head is hurting after I cry. So I do study the feelings and the reactions and the post actions or the connections or the thoughts and the way my day is going based off of different events that happen throughout that day to look for a similarity in patterns. I do that. That's the way I study it. And I go into other delves of research with it. And I may compare and contrast to the last time I cried. And then from that time, I may compare and contrast who was I around. And I'm trying to map my thoughts, to be honest with you. And that's just me. I do that every day to say, last time she did this, this happened. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, I said all that to say that just be more on it. Just be more into whatever it is you do. And nothing is as simple as it seems. You know what I'm saying? Everybody always say, yeah, you know, life is what you make it. Yeah, but if you haven't been taught to make anything, you won't make anything. If you don't know how to bake a cake, you'll starve. If you don't know how to fish, you won't catch any. I mean, you may catch one or two, just haphazardly, all just because you're trying. And then if you keep trying, you may develop some type of technique. But believe me, it's a better way of doing things once you, you know, keep trying at it. You know what I'm saying? And it's all these successful cliches I do want to delve into right quick. And people say, yeah, don't stop and all that type of stuff or whatever. A lot of that stuff is just people that just gets fascinated with going forward. And there's a thin, very thin line between self-mastering and stubbornness. I mean, supreme, sublime, ignorance, stupid, it's stupidity, stubbornness. It's a very thin line between that and genius. Because imagine Einstein wasn't, you know what I'm saying, stubborn enough to say, no, this is the way. You know? Imagine if he did do that. And I feel like there's more walking to me. You know, more individuals walking to me now. But you know what I'm saying? Like, that's just how it is. So just imagine that. So you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, so like I said, don't let nobody else decide what you need to do. But do what you need to do. And that's the purpose of this. I don't know. I guess this is my self-reality mastering concept, you know, health portion of the tape or whatever. But it's needed somewhere. It may have been needed for the person's grave I'm standing for. It may have been needed for this tree. It may have been needed. But it was needed. Nonetheless, whether it was ever heard, it was needed. You know, and that's a lot of times we worry about other people looking at us. And that stops us from doing a whole bunch of things. I mean, a lot of times I want to do something spiritual and sporadic. I'm just walking down the street, I'm like, and someone just told me, look at that or engage in that, and I didn't. Because I had other people with me who wasn't on that level. And therefore, I had to put that to sleep or let it remain dormant and didn't engage and react to certain things I thought I heard. I know we all smoking, but I don't want to seem like I'm the only one bugging, so I ain't going to say nothing. And if you keep tuning that voice out, you understand what I'm saying? I mean, it is what it is, you know? I mean, all of us are spiritual. We just need to tune in. It's just all about them who's tuned in the most. If I ride bikes every day to work, I mean, my balance may be pretty much better than yours if you drive a car every day, you know, because I'm more in touch with the environment around me. I'm in touch with every bump inside the road because I got to drive around it. You, on the other hand, are not. You could turn up your music and be blasting all the way to work and get there in a shorter time, but I may be more holistic person and see things before you do. You know what I'm saying? It's just all about how tuned in to you to whatever it is that you want to do. It's all about how tuned in you are to whatever it is that you're trying to go and how you're trying to portray yourself and what direction you're trying to go with. You got something you want to put on there?
It's a feeling I just felt. It came out of nowhere.
A bad or a good feeling?
Bad. Like I got nauseous.
Oh, for real? Well, get off the body. You standing on the, what you call it?
Okay. That wasn't the foot of it?
Yeah, it would be the foot, yeah. I would still say that.
Well, yeah. I feel better now.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
I mean, because there's certain barriers. There's certain barriers. Like when you step into a cemetery, everything has a certain energy. Everything has certain energy and spiritual barriers. Whether you realize that or not.
She died the same year I was born.
She died the same year you was born?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe her pulling from your energy, trying to...
And it was like maybe a couple of days before I was born, too.
For real?
Yeah. Let's say March 27. I was born on the 9th, April.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's just something that I... That's why I just went on ahead and just looked like, okay, who is this that I'm...
Yeah, around? Yeah, of course. I definitely want to know that. You know, and I think these are mile markers as well. These here, these are some type of markers. These are old. This stuff been here for a while. These ain't the ancient from millions of years ago. Cause I, like I said in the other tape, I think the ancient ones, they buried their dead in different places. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I don't think it's an ancient cemetery, but I know it's pretty old. Some of these graves out here date all the way back to the 1700s and slavery and stuff. So I know it's pretty old. You know what I'm saying? But we talking about like 1600s and before and stuff. You got to go deep in the country for that, and that's why I'm gonna go. I want some of those with the swamp and all that deep off in there, like East Value and Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. I'm going to those type of places, and that's why I want to do my lecture. That's why I want to pop off some of my real good rituals or whatever. But I can do it from here. I don't gotta go there to do that, but I just choose to, you know. But yeah, some of these mile markers, I think they're relevant. I've noticed them when I walk around.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's some type of cemetery stone marking or something. Because there's one right here. There's a few more the more you go along. But now that I showed you that ritual, and then you had a water ritual. If I may, I'm going to see if I got some. I don't think we got no water inside the car.
I don't think we have any type of liquids inside of it.
Okay, yeah, because I'm thirsty. But with that being said or whatever, I think it was a good day. I think it gave me about an hour worth of information. And I could just really go in depth for a whole lot more.
There's two flowers right there.
Yeah, I see that.
Hold on. My bad, I was trying to get in front of you.
It's fine.
Again.
But that's just what it is. So I think we did good. Hotel, Ashe, Amadi Gali, peace, you know, Wishbone, Islam, all the ways to say peace. Ishbayo Gada. You know, I mean, whatever. Y'all know what it is. And this is me, Dodecahedron, coming to you again. This is my Neo-Moorish Renaissance. I'm going on a whole series. Like I said, I'm going to do a whole series. And I'm going back to Sesquicentennial Park to finish up the rest of the series. And some places I'm going to go back to. The Three Rivers point, I'm done with that. I want to go to Congaree. I want to go to a couple more state parks. And I'm going to go to a couple more cemeteries. This is one of many. Like I said, I touched on a few topics. I did want to touch on a lot more, but it'll be another time for that. Believe me, it'll come. Like I said, this was more of a spur of the moment type of thing. I haven't even done editing the other two stuff I have. So I wasn't even going to do this lecture, you know, but I said, okay, cool. Information needs to get out. I feel it on my chest. It's riding me. All right, cool. Let's roll with it. Whatever comes out, comes out. Whatever doesn't, it's not need to be said. When you live a life like that, you can't do no wrong. I mean, you know what I'm saying? If people actually believe with the stuff that they be saying, you'd be straight. If you believe that, you know, God don't make no mistakes, then when you run into a tree, you won't get out and cuss everybody out in the car. It's like something just hit me. But it's true, though. If you believe that God don't make no mistakes, you won't get out and cuss everybody out in the car. Because you would know that happened for a reason. And it was some type of, you know, plan. It's divine up in there somewhere that's helping you. You may have hit that tree or ran into something to stop from blowing up down the road. That's like Kivas was telling me yesterday. His brother got out the car to talk to someone, said the car was leaking oil, and he smelled gas all through the car.
and said the brother got out to talk to one of his homeboys. Homeboy just came home, so he got outside the car to talk to him, and say as soon as he got up outside the car, whatever, the homeboy, the car blew up. Now, you know what I'm saying?
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? And he been riding all day long. So he was trying to come up there to see Kivas at some type of high school basketball game. Mm-hmm. He was in a rush. He was riding all across town, smelling all. He said the car was scraping and smelling gas all throughout the car. So it was, you know, he was like, man, shoot, man, I'm going to pull over, but I'm going to get my ride out of it. I already put gas inside here for the day.
Mm-hmm.
So he was trying to get his little ride out. Nigga got outside the car blew up. I'm not trying to say that to be like an explosive story. Like, you know how people try to say something to be, oh yeah, it's so profound. Look how spiritual things are.
Mm-hmm.
But look how spiritual things are. I'm not trying to, you know what I'm saying, tell you, you know what I'm saying, that, you know, I'm just trying to let you know that things like that happen. And when he said, I'm like, wow, like, this ain't nothing you see on TV, like Rippers Believe It or Not. This is some real stuff. And that's not just a miracle. That's just on a whole other level. That's a man who was in tune with his surrounding, and something told him to get out of the car. He listened. That's how you can be. That's how I am.
I just wiped my hand. I feel like, you know how you feel something on your hair?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, your hair stand up. Mm-hmm. Like, you ever play with your hair with your hand?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. Like,
yeah,
that.
And it's something right here that just touched me.
For real?
Yeah, on my arm.
Okay. What you think the name of it is? You think it has a name?
I didn't think that far.
Okay.
I didn't think that far. Okay. I just, you know,
but that's one of the things I want to get into, too. I'm talking to you, my queen, but I'm also talking to the people at home or whatever. You need to get into that. Like, start thinking for it. Start going further with it. When you feel, oh, there's a spirit inside the house, what's the spirit's name? How old are they? Where they from? Get to know them. Like, don't just, it's a spirit in here. If you ain't here, you hear me, leave me alone. It's not smart. When you see stuff like that going down, get in contact with them. Sometimes I close my eyes because you can't see them a lot of times with this. You can't see them a lot of times with that. So you need to close your eyes. Then look around. Then relax yourself and don't be scared, and welcome them around. Like, okay, hey, what is it that you want? You know, talk to them like a human being. And they're like, oh my God, okay. Kind of like Patrick Swayze inside that movie Whoopi Goldberg. You can hear me? You know, I mean, you know, then start talking to them just regular. I mean, they were once human. They spread it. They share that human experience. And the last thing I want to put on this tape, because I've been meaning to do something on the death, do something on the dead. All spirits and our spirits is from the past and the present. There are some spirits that are from the future. When you look at some of those grays, like those big-eyed aliens and whatnot, those are some, it came to me one day, those are human beings who went into the earth in the next 100 years after global warming went up, and that's how those type of climates made them feel. And they start like mutating themselves and creating hybrids of themselves just to sustain a greater life form. Just like they were saying, if you want to move to Mars, you would have to alter the way your lungs work. So they were saying they want to create a human being that doesn't that inhales carbon monoxide, but inhales nitrogen but doesn't exhale carbon monoxide. They wanted to exhale a different type of gas but inhale that shit. Mm-hmm. And so they wanted to re-engineer the human body to sustain life on a whole nother planet, or at different extreme measures on this planet. I'm like, wow. So, you know, they said you don't need ears, or at least the lobes of the way they look, so they're going to try to re-engineer. I said, okay, cool. Well, I got to think about that. And the spirit told me a lot of those aliens are just people from the future trying to see how people in the past looked here on earth. So you got to understand that you ain't necessarily looking at aliens. You may be looking at relatives coming to see your sorry ass. You understand what I'm saying? And they do die as well. So if it's destined for you to live, it's destined for you to hold a certain spot inside of time, then therefore it's destined for you to die at a certain time. And if it's destined for you to die at a certain time, I mean, well, therefore you can be a future spirit. You could be a future ghost or soul that's ordained and may try to talk to some relatives beforehand. Or it could be you.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you know that it's exponents of yourself that's trying to contact you here to say, hey, I don't want you to make this type of thing inside of life. You think it's, oh, that was grandpa. Yeah, because you are, you would really be confused if you really could see spirits and you could see it was your damn self talking to yourself.
Then you'll think you dead.
Then you'll think you dead, and then you'll think, oh, you'll center all your thoughts around being dead. So the spirits are not stupid. A lot of times they'll want to give you a message, and they'll use a whole bunch of people in your family, and it'll be somebody else's spirit or somebody else's family just trying to get a spirit, just trying to get a message across to you. Just like inside that movie Contact. You know what I'm saying? When he came to him, he came to him as his father. You know what I'm saying? Like, and that's how it'd be. Like, if I wanted to come to someone I don't even know, I would wear the cloak of their ancestors.
Mm-hmm.
I would wear the cloak of their ancestors. You know what I'm saying? That's what I would do. And when I come to speak to them or whatever, that's what I would do. So they would be less intimidated. They'd be more prone to listen to what I have to say. And I think that's the best idea. But until we meet again.
Love to give me super head. Love it, said she had to swallow. Doing what I said.